Do you like Phil Collins?
You and everyone you know already knows this song, and everyone, even my mailman, already knows this drum fill. Yes, this happened while I was filming this video.
Yes.
But what you probably didn't know is that this drum fill, that drum sound, was all a total accident.
I was hoping you weren't going to mention it.
Did you know that without this album, then In the Air Tonight wouldn't have happened and none of these artists would sound the same?
First, you'll taste the sordid underbelly of life on the road.
Today we're talking about Phil Collins, the story of In the Air Tonight.
You know, I think we've cracked the code.
Diving deep into it all to answer these three things. First, how did this all happen? What made Phil into the artist that he became? Second, exactly what studio mishaps made the drum sound possible, changing the course of music in the 80s and beyond? And third, I don't know, what if that accident never happened? How different would In the Air Tonight be if it was made today?
Then experience the rock and roll lifestyle of private planes, hotels, and VIP treatment.
We have three questions to answer and an insane drum sound for you to hear later, so let's dig in.
Join me for the agony and the ecstasy.
Like many of you, I was a Phil Collins fan myself, but during my research for this video, there were a few surprises in store for me as I learned about his early Genesis years, and what I found was fascinating.
Just wanted to be a drummer, and I have no idea why.
Before Phil Collins gave us the unforgettable In the Air Tonight, he was a kid from Chiswick, London. I don't even know if I'm saying that right.
Chiswick.
Born in 1951, Phil didn't come from a musical family, but he still took to the music, especially the drums.
When I was about 5 years old, my uncles made me a kit of drums that fitted into a suitcase.
It wasn't long before he felt the need for something more, and he traded it in for a real one. By the time he was 12, he had landed a role as the Artful Dodger in Oliver on London's West End. This was Phil's introduction to the spotlight, and here's where things start getting interesting. In his teenage years, Phil contemplated a shift away from music. A brief period at drama school had him pondering a future in acting instead of behind a drum set. It's hard to imagine music today without his contributions, right? Music won him back, of course, but a few unexpected turns were in store for him along the way. It's wild things floating about. Phil Collins was 19 when he joined Genesis in 1970, with the band already 3 years old. Formed in 1967, the initial lineup consisted of Tony Banks on keyboards, Mike Rutherford on bass, Peter Gabriel as lead vocalist, Anthony Phillips on guitar, and Chris Stewart behind the drums. Yet by 1970, changes in the lineup prompted the search for a new drummer, a role perfectly filled by Phil Collins. I didn't mean to write that.
The path is clear.
Phil's inclusion brought a fresh sound to the group. With his powerful sound and a talent for backing vocals, he added a new layer to the band's music. During these years, Genesis was solidifying its reputation as a leading figure in progressive rock. They didn't write simple tunes to hum along to, they composed experiences, characterized by intricate instrumentals, complex time signatures, and multi-layered narratives. The 1971 album Nursery Crime introduced fans to Phil's drumming for the first time. Songs like The Musical Box and the sprawling The Return of the Giant Hogweed demonstrated a new dimension in the band's sound. And the band credited Phil as being the best drummer they'd worked with at that point. Well, this is interesting because this is right the same era of Yes that I would listen to, but it's just so totally different. Wow. 10 minutes long, we gotta move forward. The following year, Foxtrot hit the shelves. With it came the sidelong suite Supper's Ready, a piece that has since become emblematic of the band's ambitious songwriting. Their longest recorded song, this 23-minute track, took listeners on a journey from one soundscape to another, and Phil's drums underpinned it all to create a powerful sound with the band. Way back in 1972, you could already hear a taste of the drumming magic that would later create In the Air Tonight. But there's a little bit more that had to fall in place first. As Genesis continued to grow in prominence, 1973's Selling England by the Pound is now hailed as a masterpiece. Critics lauded tracks like The Cinema Show and The Firth of Fifth for their lyrical depth and instrumental chops.
Man, that is a killer drum sound. And the snare is cracking. There's a bass or a synth bass supporting it with some really good low end, especially for the 70s. Whew. And then he has that like the high tuned tom kind of thing going on. It adds a lot of energy that you don't get with the more standard modern deeper tom sound. It's very Billy Cobham, right?
In fact, Phil recalls being influenced by Mahavishnu Orchestra and Billy Cobham at the time, and you can clearly hear this reflected in Genesis's music. On this album, Tony Banks's haunting keyboard melodies combined seamlessly with Phil's drumming and Peter Gabriel's evocative lyrics. And they were starting to see more success, as they released their first single to chart in the UK. Yet, beneath the success and the acclaim, not everything was smooth.
Ever since 1975, there have been a variety of rumors floating around.
As the years went on, subtle strains began to emerge within the group, with individual visions occasionally clashing. And while Peter Gabriel's compelling stage presence was undeniably a significant part of their allure...
Personally, I didn't like what I felt I was becoming in that role. The thing itself, because of its success, was becoming a little more conservative, you know. Now, if I want to do something which appears stupid or unnecessarily dangerous or risky to the other people I work with in a band, in a sort of democratic setup, other people's livelihoods that I was fucking up.
The band finished a successful tour of Europe and North America in support of the album and decided to book 3 months at Headley Grange, yes, to write their new material for the next album. I'm going to skip over Headley Grange's fascinating musical history today, but if you want more of that, you'll find a link to my video deconstructing Led Zeppelin and the making of When the Levee Breaks in the description below. Despite setbacks, the band moved forward with recording, not at Headley Grange, but instead in Wales at a studio whose name I refuse to attempt to pronounce. By the time The Lamb Lies Down on Broadway was released in 1974, the riffs were becoming more pronounced. A concept album, it narrated the surreal journey of a street kid in New York City. The recording process for this double album was intense and at times fraught with disagreements. Peter Gabriel, deeply involved in the storyline, sometimes found himself at odds with other members over the direction the album was taking. This culmination of tensions led to the inevitable. In 1975, just as the band was grappling with its newfound success, Peter Gabriel made the shocking announcement of his departure from Genesis. This decision didn't just leave a gap in the band's lineup, it left fans and members alike questioning their future. The voice and face of the band had walked away.
It was quite a leisurely sort of panic.
As the world speculated about the future of the band, little did they know that this departure would pave the way for some very surprising events. And as we'll see later, these events shaped Phil Collins into who we remember today.
Remember when I said that In the Air Tonight was an accident? That's because the sound of the record just would not be possible if it wasn't for these three things. Gates, talkback mics, and an unusual request Peter Gabriel made to Phil. Now, we'll have to get to Peter's request later, because first, here's a quick background on what you need to know. All right, let's talk about gates. Imagine you have a fence around your yard, and this fence has a gate in it that only lets in the people that you want. In audio terms, this is similar to what we call a gate in recording. You get to let in only the sounds that you decide. A gate in audio is like the gatekeeper. It lets certain sounds in while keeping others out. When the sound is loud enough, the gate opens, and when the sound is quiet, the gate closes. This is super handy when you want to get rid of unwanted noise, like the hum of an amplifier. You might be wondering, why not just turn down the volume? Here's the thing. Sometimes you might want to hear part of the sound, like the attack of this drum, but not the tiny noises and the pauses in between. And that's where gates become indispensable in crafting the In the Air Tonight sound. The threshold is the most important part of the gate. Think of the threshold as a height marker at an amusement ride. If the sound is tall enough or loud enough, it gets to go on the ride. But if it's below that marker, it's kept out. That means by adjusting the threshold, you get to decide how loud a sound needs to be before the gate lets it through.
Now we need to get back to Phil. In the aftermath of Peter Gabriel's departure, Phil Collins felt that the group could continue on without a lead singer, but the other band members disagreed, which meant Genesis faced a challenge that would have caused lesser bands to fold, finding a new frontman who could command the stage and capture the unique spirit of the band.
We put an advert in the Melody Maker, you know, Genesis stroke Yes type group want singer, right? And see what we came up with. And we did come up with a few, a lot of replies, about 400 replies, with tapes and with records that people had made, or the records, tapes of people singing along to our records, all kinds of things.
Meanwhile, the band decided to begin recording instrumental tracks and audition singers as they went.
Did anyone come close?
Not really, yeah, it was quite depressing.
Peter Gabriel even visited the band in the studio and listened to the album, and was impressed that they were, in his own words, a whole strong band without me. And so numerous candidates stepped forward, hoping to fill the void left by Peter.
Please welcome for a quick chat, Phil Collins!
Phil, mate. Phil Collins.
Yet as the auditions progressed, something curious was unfolding behind the scenes. Throughout the recording and audition process, Phil Collins was in the studio singing backup as he usually did. He didn't want to take over as the permanent lead vocalist, and instead he opted to coach potential candidates the material.
They'd come down and they'd sing. I'd teach them some of the songs and then they'd sing it, and we'd say, okay, we'll keep you in mind, you know? And there was one guy that got through all those auditions sort of and actually came into the studio with us. To try Squonk, which was on Trick of the Tail. And it didn't work at all. And everyone was started. And I was really there saying, well, just give me a chance, man. You know, give me a break. Because I didn't want to say, you know, like, I want to do it. I wanted to be asked, you know.
But as the auditions continued, band members Tony Banks and Mike Rutherford began to realize that the perfect voice, the right fit they were seeking, was already with them. And when Phil finally recorded vocals for one of their new songs, Squonk, it was obvious. The band collectively decided that Phil Collins was the right choice to front Genesis.
I'm also going to say this, like, Genesis, where have you been all my life? This is fantastic. I wish I'd been listening to this. Holy crap.
Making the transition from drummer to lead singer might seem like a leap, but Phil's vocal abilities were evident long before this. It wasn't just his technical ability, but the emotive quality of his voice that lent itself so perfectly to the music of Genesis.
What the
Phil?
Okay, that's a little in the air hint, right? It's a little telegraph. Bum 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 bum. What? The drum sound is fantastic. Still sounded like Phil. That's a killer drum sound. But let's dig in for a moment.
With Collins now both behind the drums and the microphone, they released A Trick of the Tail as the band's first post-Gabriel album in 1976. With it came a significant shift in the band's sound. While the progressive elements remained, there was a more accessible tone to their music. The album was a success, proving to fans and critics alike that Genesis could not only survive, but thrive. They had survived the departure of Peter Gabriel and found their new voice in Phil Collins. But before we can get to Phil's solo career and that In the Air Tonight accident, ingredient number two in that formula was talkback mics. What are talkback microphones? This is a talkback mic. It lets me hit a button and everyone in the studio will hear me talk and give them feedback. And it can go both ways. Some talkback mics go from the live room to the control room. That's going to become very important in a moment. Phil continued to track the drum parts, but they needed a solution when touring live. So they turned to none other than Bill Bruford, who toured with them in 76, but Bill declined to continue touring with them the following year. Phil Collins had to find another drummer to fill his shoes.
Phil Collins.
Right.
Chester Thompson.
The addition of Chester Thompson was another masterstroke. Before joining Genesis, Thompson had already established his reputation with Frank Zappa and Weather Report. His background made him the ideal choice to collaborate with Genesis, given the band's intricate musical style.
Well, how did you audition for Genesis then?
Well, Phil just called up and says, you know, I saw you play with Weather Report. Phil was told me later, while he was at the Weather Report concert with another friend of his, he said he ended up saying to the guy, if I have to play with another drummer, I sure would like it to be that guy.
When on tour, while Phil took center stage as the lead vocalist, it was Chester who took over behind the drums, ensuring the band's rhythm section lost none of its punch.
And I remember being quite worried because I was on my way to rehearsals and I ran into Daryl Sturmer at the airport in Chicago. He was returning from somewhere, I think with his Jean Dupont or something. And I was saying, man, I'm going over to do rehearsals with this band Genesis, and he gets this worried look on his face. He says, man, are you gonna have to wear costumes? And I thought, uh-oh, what am I getting into here?
Even though I'm not even familiar with Genesis, I do have a little bit of a personal link in history to them in that my drum teacher was taught by Chester Thompson.
I don't know if you can call it anything significant, but even though I wasn't familiar at all with Chester Thompson's playing or his discography growing up, somehow when I watch Chester today, I could see the DNA in his drumming and how I play because of the teachings that were passed down to me. So that's pretty cool. And I have one more connection with In the Air Tonight that I want to share with you. But first, we need to answer how all of this made In the Air Tonight possible. Trust me, it's all coming together.
Really, Phil and I hit it off immediately. I mean, you would have thought we'd known each other and played together for years, actually.
The albums that followed this transition saw Genesis reaching new heights. Wind and Wuthering, am I saying that right? In 1977, retained some of the band's prog rock elements, but also hinted at the more mainstream rock sound they'd later adopt. Genesis continued to release successful albums, with Phil leading the band, most notably with Duke in 1980, where the band ventured further into pop territory, achieving significant commercial success.
I've been a big Genesis fan ever since the release of their 1980 album, Duke. Before that, I really didn't understand any of their work. It's too artsy, too intellectual. It was on Duke where Phil Collins' presence became more apparent.
It was paying off. The band was reaching a brand new audience. Listen to the evolution occurring in their music. It became more polished, more radio-friendly. The recording techniques they experimented with during this period, especially during the Duke sessions, included something called gated reverb. Right now, I want you to take a listen to this and remember it for later because it's going to be very important in a moment. As the 80s dawned, Phil was on the brink of a transformation. His experiences with Genesis, both as a drummer and then as a lead vocalist, had given him the confidence, skills, and the ambition to go solo. You all know how this went from here. Phil Collins releases Face Value, and In the Air Tonight becomes a timeless classic. The Tarzan soundtrack was a total banger. The end, right? Wrong. Because we still haven't talked about that accident in the studio that changed everything for Phil.
Thanks to you, we have children in our town that like Phil Collins.
What? You see, the Phil Collins we know today wouldn't be possible if it wasn't for this accident. And if Phil doesn't have a solo career, Chester Thompson doesn't back him on tour, and he doesn't cross paths with my drum teacher. Fast forward 20 years, and I don't cross paths with my drum teacher because he was never taught by Chester Thompson. And so none of that drum education is passed on to me, and I just totally suck on the drums today. I have no career in music, and this video is never made. And of course, much more tragically, we don't get...
You don't have to go this hard, Phil. But
thankfully, and I'm personally grateful for this, that is not the world we live in. So what went right here? Well, we can trace the incident back to late 1979, when Phil Collins was at Townhouse Studios with none other than Peter Gabriel. Peter was working on his solo material and invited Phil to play drums on the record. Remember how I said before Peter made an unusual request to Phil? Well, Peter Gabriel famously hated cymbals on his recordings. He was known for asking his drummers to omit playing them all together, and I'm pretty sure this went on for years before cymbals appeared to any significant degree on any of Peter's solo albums.
No cymbals and no hi-hat, because Peter didn't want a whole bunch of splashing around noisy things to take up any room in the mix.
So, no cymbals. Remember that. During the session, the engineer was setting up an overhead mic in the drum room, intending to use this as a talkback mic for Phil. But Hugh accidentally engaged the mic at the wrong time. So when Phil played the drums, the heavily compressed talkback mic gave the drums an unbelievable sound.
But the trick was always to keep the drums sounding really big, but also to have everything else, because you've had everything else coming in, keeping it all sounding big.
The natural reverb of the room was smashed by the compressors in the talkback circuit, and then the gates on the board cut out that reverb very quickly.
But the crucial thing is there's no cymbals.
Overnight, this SSL 4000 board was rewired so that the talkback mic could be properly routed and recorded for the album.
If the minute you put cymbals in there, it would mess it up sonically, and that was the thing with the Intruder as well, no cymbals at all.
And thus, the gated reverb sound of the 80s was born.
No, it sounds great still, doesn't it?
This became a sound Phil Collins improved upon in several of his next recordings, culminating, of course, with the drum sound we all know and love to this day. In the Air Tonight quickly ascended the charts. Upon its release in 1981, it became a beacon in pop culture. It was famously used in this scene of Risky Business and the very first episode of Miami Vice. And it's just a timeless song at this point. Nearly 40 years later, a reaction video by this channel, Twins the New Trend, got over 6 million views in 3 weeks, leading to digital sales of In the Air Tonight to spike and reach number 2 on iTunes in 2020. What?
They're actually going to go to a Phil Collins concert.
So remember when I said,
what if that accident never happened? How different would In the Air Tonight be if it was made today?
Of course.
I actually decided to take a stab at answering this. If I had to get that drum moment in a different way, what would I do? The story here is that when my bandmate Marissa asked if we could cover the song, I was faced with a very big challenge.
I mean, I was worried immediately.
How do you do justice to In the Air Tonight and that drum fill?
Oh, I'm all tangled up here.
If I just did what everyone expected, if I just made the drums sound big and did the drum fill you all know was coming, it would be a bit of a letdown.
Honestly, I can't think of any other example of like an instrumental soundbite that is that iconic.
I don't want to step on that drum fill's legacy. But it's also the most important part of the song to get right, so it had to be there.
What made you think it was a good choice for us to do together?
I was in Durango, Colorado, and I was set up on a street corner busking. That part would come, it's no stranger to you and me. And then there'd be someone out there, it'd be like, guck. And I would even do that into the mic sometimes. I'd be like, bup. And so everyone knows that drum fill, and I was just thinking about how like, you're one of the most phenomenal drummers I've ever worked with or even heard. I don't know, that's like the drum song. So it just felt like a no-brainer.
Yeah, I was like, what do I do?
One does not simply cover.
So I came up with an idea. And until I recorded that idea, our placeholder fill was pretty hilarious.
It's no stranger to you and me.
Because when I hear that song, I hear heartfelt, I hear longing, I hear anger, frustration, but you really highlighted the beauty of the song because it's also beautiful. How did you overcome that feeling of, I don't know if I can broach this song and still kind of go through and like produce anyway?
During the recording process, I finally came up with an idea that might actually work. Drums. Well, to be more specific, I mean Taiko drums.
Right.
We actually had just such a drum at the studio already. So I put it to good use and I'm pretty happy with the results.
Well, the hurt doesn't show, but the pain still grows. It's no stranger to you and me. I can feel it coming in the air tonight. Oh, Lord.
Taking on In the Air Tonight was intimidating. That drum fill is iconic, and the rest of the song, I mean, it's Phil Collins.
I feel like there's a catharsis to that song that I think we did do well. And I do want people to feel that music can cut through that, where someone could be in gridlock traffic, running late for the meeting that would be their next promotion, and now maybe they're gonna lose it. And they're screaming and they're honking and nothing's happening. And then they hear a certain song and all of a sudden, there's space again.
That's what Phil did for so many of us, and we've poured our hearts into this cover, and now we're sharing it with you. No Radio is just a two-person band, and we are completely independent and self-funded, so we could really use your help and support to get the word out. If you love Phil Collins as much as we do, or if you have any friends or family that would like what we do, share it with them and click here to watch the video. You can find links to follow us and listen to all of No Radio's music in the description below. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you over there.